Bank. As Group Managing Director of First Bank, the 14th Emir of Kano, one of the leading lights of Islam, not just on the continent, but globally. And today, the topic we have chosen for him today is something that is very important to him and should be important to all of us as members of the Ummah. How do we empower the Ummah economically and financially to ensure that the Ummah, the members of the Ummah, are not economically and financially excluded from this evolving and rapidly evolving modern world? He did actually warn me that you have loved that I serve him a longer notice than I did. So whatever gap or inadequacies comes out of this, I would take responsibility for that, but not Khalifa. But as usual, I'm sure we are all looking forward to a very erudite delivery that will basically put this on the front burner among all of us as Muslims to say, how do we consciously help to uplift other members of the Ummah such that the people, when you're looking at the people at the base of the pyramid, they are economically and financially empowered, and we begin to look at a more prosperous Muslim Ummah. He's currently a scholar at Oxford. Again, once you're a scholar, you're a scholar. For those who are very familiar and close to Khalifa. So it's a privilege that he agreed to accept my invitation to speak with us this morning out of his very, very busy schedule, especially during Ramadan. Bismillah, sir. We are privileged to have you, sir. Thank you, sir.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillah. Wa salatu wa salamu ala Rasulillah. Sayyidina wa Nabiyyina Muhammadin ibn Abdullah wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa mawalah. Wa ba'd, assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Wa alaykum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. You're welcome, Khalifa. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much. I'd like to thank Shola for the invitation to share some thoughts on this subject. As he said, the notice was short, and in fact, he had given me some very complex intellectual topic on, I think, financial architecture or something. I told him there was no way I was going to start doing research in 2 days to speak on a very complex topic, and he should simplify it, because I would just like to share some thoughts with brothers and sisters in these difficult economic times where there's mass poverty and where many people, including many in the Ummah, are finding themselves in dire straits. And I suppose for me, what I've been thinking about in the last few months is how we have focused so much on the formal financial institutions and are waiting for those to be the source of financial empowerment for people, rather than go back to the basics, which is that when you look at Islamic jurisprudence, for example, the fiqh mu'amalat, you'll find that the economy was running, there was circulation of money, and there were no formal institutions like banks and insurance companies. So in many parts of the country today, particularly where you've got huge levels of financial exclusion and a lack of literacy, we have also created a situation where we're waiting for formal institutions to be the source of finance. So I thought just going over the solutions that have been provided by Islamic jurisprudence on this matter would help us think, especially those of us who have the good fortune to be in positions where we may be able to help those who are less privileged, to think of the different ways and the multiple ways in which we can be of assistance. And I think I would like to begin by just reminding us of two verses of the Quran that lay the foundation for what we're talking about and for the circulation of wealth among the Ummah. The first is the verse where Allah says, وَآتِ ذَا الْقُرْبَى حَقَّهُ والمسكين وابن السبيل ولا تبذر تبذيرا إن المبذرين كانوا إخوان الشياطين وكان الشيطان لربه كفورا. Where Allah tells us to give those who are close to us and those who are poor and those who are wayfarers their right. First of all, he says it is their right. He does not say it is a privilege, it is left to us, it is a right on our wealth that we provide those who do not have. And then he, at the same time, warns us not to be wasteful and extravagant. Wala tubathir tabthira, reminding us that those who are extravagant, who basically just spend money carelessly on what they do not need, because that's what extravagance is, tabthira in Islam, is just is to waste money, to spend on something beyond your means. And we see it all along. You know, we're in a country where there's so much tabthira. People build mansions they do not need. People buy things that they do not need instead of using the surplus wealth to support those who do not have. People buy jewelry of and just keep that they never use, you know, just for the fun of it. And this is all tabdhir. And Allah says, إِنَّ الْمُبَذِّرِينَ كَانُوا إِخْوَانَ الشَّيَاطِينَ, those who are extravagant, those who are wasteful with the resources that Allah has given them, are brothers or brethren of the Satans, of the devils. And Shaytan is ungrateful to his Lord. So this is a very, very serious verse. And when you think through the lifestyle that we run, when you think through, in fact, many of the people who go after wealth in our society, you'll find that the focus for many of them is to raise money that they do not need and spend on things that they do not even use. So this is the first verse. The second verse came in connection with the faith, which is the proceeds that you get as a result of war, where Allah says, مَا أَفَاءَ اللَّهُ لَا رَسُولِهِ مِنْ أَهْلِ الْقُرَىٰ فَلِلَّهِ وَلِلْرَسُولِ وَلِذِي الْقُرْبَى وَلِيَتَامَى وَالْمَسَاكِينِ كَيْ لَا يَكُونَ دُولَةً بَيْنَ الْأَغْنِيَاءِ مِنْكُمْ مَا آتَاكُمُ الرَّسُولُ فَخُذُوهُ وَمَا نَهَاكُمْ عَنْهُ فَانْتَهُوا. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala refers to all the wealth that comes to the Ummah as a result of victory in war, the spoils of war. And he says these spoils should be to Allah and the Prophet and to the poor people and relatives and those who are destitute. And he then sets up the logic for that. He says, Kayla yakuna dulatan, or kayla tukuna dulatan bain al-aghniyai minkum, so that the wealth does not circulate only among the rich. Now this verse talks about the importance of wealth that is in the hands of the rich circulating and dripping down to the poor. Okay, we do not, the wealth should not just circulate among the wealthy. So when you have all these huge income inequalities, these have been discouraged by the Quran very clearly. When all the wealth just moves from one bank account to another bank account, from one bank account to the stock exchange, and it's not dripping down to the people, and to the poor people, even if it's circulating, coming, because he says, it can leave your account to the poor and come back to you, but it should circulate across society. Now, how does Islam provide for this circulation? Most of us tend to think that the only way this world circulates is there are the two well-known ways. One, of course, is zakah. إِنَّمَا صَدَقَاتُ الْفُقَرَاءِ وَالْمَسَاكِينِ وَالْآمِلِينَ عَلَيْهَا وَالْمُؤَلَّفَةِ قُلُوبِهِمْ وَفِي الرِّقَابِ وَالْغَارِمِينَ وَفِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ وَابْنِ السَّبِيلِ, to the eight categories that are the recipients of zakah, and also sadaqah, الَّذِينَ فِي أَمْوَالِهِمْ حَقٌّ مَعْلُومٌ لِلسَّائِلِ وَالْمَحْرُومِ. So we think the only way that this wealth circulates, the only way we can help the poor, is to give them zakah and to give them sadaqah. The reality is, if you have wealth as an individual, you can be your own bank. You can use this wealth to provide all sorts of finance that will lead to the empowerment of the poor. And there are many ways in which you can help them. Okay. Again, after apart from Sadaqah, is called the Hassan. Okay, in the form of look when these people come, giving them interest-free loans. Some of us feel we're too big to lend money to a poor person who's in need. And if we cannot give him Sadaqah, then we just say no. Okay. But in fact, giving somebody a loan when he's in need is actually more rewarding than Sadaqah. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in hadith that he saw written on one of the gates of Al-Jannah, As-sadaqatu bi-asharati amthaliha wal-daynu bi-thamaniyata ashar. That when you give a sadaqah, you get its reward 10 times. But when you give a loan, you get the reward 18 times. And the companion said, Ya Rasulullah, ma balu dayni afdalu min as-sadaqah. Prophet of Allah, how come lending someone is more beneficial and more rewarding than giving him sadaqah? And he said, لِأَنَّ السَّائِلَ يَسْأَلُ وَعِنْدَهُ أَمَّ الْمُسْتَقْرِطِ فَلَا يَسْتَقْرِطْ إِلَّا عِنْدَ الْحَاجَةِ. He said, because he who asks, he who begs, may be asking you, may be begging you, and he has something. Somebody who has money can still beg. But somebody who comes to borrow only borrows as a result of need. So when you give a loan, you are giving somebody who you are sure needs. If he had money, he would not be borrowing money. But when you give a sadaqah, you'll be giving somebody who has and who just keeps asking people. So it also tells us the meaning of a loan in Islam. A loan in Islam is not a loan you give somebody to conduct business. When you lend someone in Islam, when you give a loan in Islam, it is because the person is in need. The person needs money to feed himself. The person needs money for basic necessities, and the person cannot afford it. And therefore, you give him a loan until he is in a position to pay back. Now, and you give him time to pay back. فَإِنْ كَانَ ذُو أُسْرَةٍ فَنَذِرَةٌ إِلَى مَيْسَرَةٍ. If he's in a difficult strait, you wait for him until he has ease. And then if at the end of the day, you feel that this person is not able to pay, at that point, you can then do the sadaqah and get the reward of the loan and the reward of the sadaqah. Allah says, وَأَنْتَ صَدَّقُوا خَيْرٌ لَكُمْ إِنْ كُنْتُمْ تَعْلَمُونَ. So if a loan is not for business, if a loan is not for commercial activity, how does Islam provide? How do you help a poor person get economically empowered? The principle in Islam is if anybody wants to do a business and he comes to you for money, you are not giving him a loan. He's asking you to participate in that business. Okay, so you go into, if you put in money in a business, you're putting in money to be a partaker in the profits or the losses of the business. And I would mention a few of the products. These are products that have been offered by Islamic banks, but these are things that we as individuals can do. And in fact, in Muslim countries, in Muslim societies, in Muslim empires, this was common. You know, in every ward, in every market, in every area, people did this all the time. And this is something that has disappeared. In your neighborhood, you've got poor people who want to set up micro enterprises, who are artisans. You have women who are married, we have married men who are very poor, who need a little capital to do business. How do you support these people in a manner that is not sadaqah, and that is not zakah, and that is not qard? How do you take all those millions out of the bank, okay, and help get them to circulate, as Allah says, kaylai takuna dulatan, that they do not just circulate among the wealthy. How do you get them to circulate to the poor? Go in and then come back to you, and probably come back to you in an enhanced manner. You make a profit. You make the money grows for you, but you also complying with this divine instruction for the circulation of wealth. So the products, I'm sorry if many people here are familiar with the products. I don't know the audience and how familiar they are with Islamic banking and Islamic finance and fiqh mu'amalat, but they're very simple products, and I think if we just understand them and try to think through, we can, in our own small communities, take responsibility. If you empower 5 people or 10 people, if you empower 20 poor women, you know, you help in bringing the ummah out of poverty. So one product that's well known is what's called mutaraba in Hanafi fiqh, or qirat in Maliki, Shafi'i, and Hanbali fiqh. The word mutaraba has become the more common one in Islamic finance, but that's the Hanafi term. And it is what we all know as agency relationships, where you've got poor people who have a talent, who have a capacity for doing things, who have ideas, but who do not have the resources to finance those things. And you believe that this is an idea or a business that can earn money, a business that can make profit. And you effectively turn them into agents, where you provide them with the finance, and their responsibility is to manage the money in that business and then take a share of the profit, okay, with the aim ultimately of returning the capital to you with some share of the profit. You agree on the share of the profit. Tell them they can do 50% of the profit, or 20% of the profit, or 30% of the profit, and that's so that's one product, and I think it's something that we all can do, whether they want to be tailors or they want to buy a deep freezer to sell Coke, set up a small kiosk, you know, and not large amounts, but you can work with them. Provide them with small finance and share the profit. Another product is the musharaka, or partnership, where they do have some capital. They are already in some small business, but they want to expand the business. And you're able to call them and say, look, okay, this business, you have $500,000 in that business. Okay, I'm going to give you another $500,000 or $1 million so that you can expand the scale of your business, but you're going to give me 30% of the profit. And they go, they expand the business, they increase their profits, they become wealthier, and they give you a share of the profit, and continues. And this is called musharaka. Another one which I see happening a lot in the north now is ijara, which is lease. And I see that largely with people who are doing transportation, people who buy these tricycles or taxis, where some wealthy relatives would buy a car or a tricycle and give a cousin to go and be driving around as a taxi driver. And then they pay like a lease every month, come and bring in some money until the cost is recovered and some profit, and then the product ends up in their hands. There's also kafala, which is like a guarantee. So if you don't want to lend them money, you can send us a guarantor for them. Where they find someone who will lend them money. It could be a bank, it could be somebody else that doesn't know them very well, or who trusts you and relies on you. And you say, okay, I stand as a guarantor, lend them the money so they can go and do their business. And if they do not pay back, I will pay. And for them as well, I think you could organize them when they're in the trade to do their own insurance, their own takaful, where. And I always give the example of these drivers of keke napep and tricycles who rely on that for their livelihood, and when the tricycle gets burnt up or stolen, that's it. They end up doing nothing, and the whole idea of takaful is people coming together to take care of each other. So you would expect them to make a small payment every month into a pool, with the understanding that if any one of them had a disaster befall them, an accident or a theft, or basically the engine knocks through no fault of theirs, that fund would replace the tricycle for them. And that is what Islamic insurance or takaful is based on. So the point I'm making is that all these things we've seen with Islamic banks like Jais and Lotus and the takaful companies, these are fantastic developments that we should encourage and we hope will spread. But look, every one of us can be a bank. Every one of us can organize an insurance. And when we now begin to take responsibility, and remember that we're all living in neighborhoods where there are poor people. And when Allah says, talks about what is birr, what is a good thing. When he says, وَلَكِنَّ الْبِرَّ مَنْ آمَنَ بِاللَّهِ وَيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ وَأَقَامَ الصَّلَاةَ وَآتَى الزَّكَاةَ, then he says, وَآتَى الْمَالَ لَهُ بِهِ مِسْكِينًا وَيَتِيمًا. No, that's not the verse I want. Where he talks about in Baqarah, where he refers to a whole list of people that we give money as part of birr, and he mentions al-jari dhil qurba wa al-jari al-junubi wa sahib bil jambi wa ibn al-sabili wa ma malakat aymanukum. So he talks about al-jari dhil qurba, he talks about your neighbor who is your relative, and he says wa al-jari al-junub, and talks about your neighbor who is not your relative. So we have this responsibility to take care of these neighbors in our communities, in our small areas. And the scholars say that your neighbor, when the Quran says jar, people have said you're talking about 40 houses to your left, 40 houses to your right, 40 houses, 40 houses to the north, 40 to the east, 40 to the south, 40 to the west. So a whole radius of 40 houses in any direction, you can count them as your neighbors. In that radius, you would find many poor women. You'd find many unemployed youth. You'll find many orphans. And if you just make the effort, really in this Ramadan, to begin to identify them, call them in and ask them if they have business ideas. Find how you can help them with small amounts, okay, and have an agreement where you empower them. They don't need to go to a bank. They don't need to have all these KYC documents. You know them, they're your neighbors, you know where they live, you know their parents. And I think if we did more and more of that, we would be able to contribute to the upliftment of the Ummah, the empowerment of the poor, and the alleviation of poverty. So this is, I like this conversation because this is something, this conversation I'm actually trying to start in Kano and in other parts where you've got so much poverty. Instead of waiting for all these palliatives, instead of waiting until banks open branches, especially now that new banks have new capitalization requirements, and some may even be going back to regional banks, so we may have fewer banks reaching us. Let's all try and be banks. Let's all try and provide this finance, this empowerment, and let's take this as part of the responsibility. And let us understand that it is an obligation, because the idea of wealth circulating only among the wealthy, as I said, that's why I said those two verses, circulating among the wealthy is an idea that is antithetical to the teachings of the Quran, and also the idea that we have all this massive wealth that we spend on things that we do not need and that will not benefit us in this world. Or in the hereafter, you build houses that you do not even benefit from in this world. You buy cars that you do not use, and this is a life that we have created for ourselves. So we do not benefit from this in this world. We do not benefit from it in the hereafter. We can use this wealth which God has given us to seek the face of Allah, to seek the pleasure of Allah, to help the poor people around us in a manner that will empower them and take them out of poverty. So this is for me. I'll give a speech for about 20 minutes. I think I've done about 30. I think would probably take more in the Q&A, and hopefully I'll be able to answer some of the questions that will come up. Thank you very much for the opportunity again, and I do hope that you found this useful.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Your Highness. Indeed, I believe you have opened up a very important conversation for the entire. You have opened up a very important conversation, which I believe what we are doing today is essentially to start and kickstart that conversation. How do we help the Ummah, especially those who have, like you said. I believe the next phase is question and answer. Adewale, over to you.
Okay, sir. Thank you very much, sir. Khalifa, we have people from the audience that have actually indicated. We also do have people that have actually used the Q&A tab. So we will alternate between the Q&A tab and as well as from the audience. So I want to take two from the Q&A tab while and then give the opportunity for the audience. But we'll take more from the Q&A tab so that we can manage our time. I understand that you really do not have all the time for this. Thank you, sir. So the first question goes thus. Do we, as the Muslims, have to constantly and continually assist physically capable family members or friends who choose not to do any form of work or trade after several intervention? When is the cutoff period of the support, and what is the Islamic prescribed treatment of this unhealthy self-entitlement of other hard-earned income? Muslim, this is actually about the physically challenged people and who are actually begging. This is actually what the question is coming for. Let me take the second question before I hand over to you, Khalifa. The second question is financial literacy not the basis to get out of our poverty, including basic education? There's a lot of illiteracy in the Ummah worldwide. Even many educated people don't invest. More of a comment, but if you can actually put more onto that, sir. Thank you, sir. Over to you, sir, Khalifa.
Yeah, so the first question, I'm a bit confused. You started by talking about those who choose not to help themselves. I think you said they're physically handicapped.
Yes, the people that are really physically capable members. The people that are physically capable, but really they do not want to work and they feel entitled. That's actually what the first question is for.
Okay, so I think this is the point I'm making. People just think that the only way they can help these people is just give them money, almost as sadaqah. And I'm saying that if you said to them that you put in the money, but they should be they should find what to do, and you give them the finance to do what they're doing, and I make it a business proposition, you probably encourage them to work. And you tell them, if you don't get up to find something to do, if you refuse to work, then I'm not going to give you anything. And that is normal. I think if you have a younger brother who decides to just sit at home and do nothing, okay, you're not obliged to just keep feeding them. In any case, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has said that begging is something that you should do only when it's absolutely necessary. He said to go out and cut wood in the forest with a rope and an axe, and come and sell, and your family is more honorable to you than to go and beg people, whether or not they give you. He said that whoever opens for himself the door to begging opens for himself the door to permanent poverty. So the reality is begging in Islam is absolutely discouraged. People should actually beg when they are in absolute need, when they have done their best for themselves and failed to do for themselves. However, there is people who want to work, who know how to make money, but who do not have the funds. And I think the more we begin to think of ourselves as enablers, as people who provide finance, to these people, the more we are able to contribute to poverty alleviation. On the second question, yes, basic education is absolutely necessary. And this is one of the best investments we can make. We all know that education and health are the essence for development. And if the investment we make in the family, say with an orphan, instead of just giving them money, is to provide a scholarship, is to allow that orphan to get an education, we are making as much an investment in that economic in the economic empowerment than giving them money, maybe much more than giving them money. And we all know that we do it for our children. The best thing we give our children is an education, and this is what we should be doing as much as possible to those that we want to help.
Okay, so I have about three people from the audience, which I've actually put. Alaji Lawal Kanika Ibrahim will go first. Then after Laiman. Alaji Lawal, go ahead, sir.
Assalamu alaikum. Your Highness Khalifa and everything in the Nigerian economy. I am Lord Kenki Ibrahim Wazir and Kenkia. Having heard you, and what I want to put in is we have an NGO, so-called initiative. What we do is actually is we train these out-of-school youth in after, let's say, an 8-week training program. We give them starter packs where they go there and start up their own business. We are not giving them a loan. So in other words, from what you are saying is, you talked of Sadaqat loan, but ours is free. After training them in the various skills, we give them these starter packs as free. How can you classify such an arrangement?
What you need Sadaqa, but you see from a financial perspective, you want it to be sustainable. And one way to sustain it is to see for those of them how this fund could be, okay, an investment where you give them the money and you expect them to give you certain returns, your partners, you follow them. That way you make sure, first of all, that they use the money properly because you monitor them. Also, the fund comes in and then it is able to be used for other people because you also need sustainability. The reality is if you're going to keep doing this all the time and just giving startup money, how much money do you have? How many people are you going to keep getting to put in the money? After some time, you begin to get donor fatigue. But if you have a plan where even if it is a part of that money that comes back, okay, or that money comes back with a profit using any of these products, you are then able to have a revolving fund and you're able to help more and more people.
You will explore it, actually. Thank you very much.
Okay, sir, thank you. The next person is Sulaiman. Sulaiman, can you enable your mic, please?
Hello, have I been heard?
Yes, we can hear you. Go ahead.
What is that? Recorded version of the laptop can be obtained. Basically, that is one question. And then two is I just want to thank Dr. Kong gesture. And I think it is very, very pertinent, especially in these times of hardship. So that's just my contribution. Thank you very much.
Sorry, I didn't hear the questions from Alex Zeman.
Sorry, what I said is that I want to thank you, first of all, and the organizers of the lecture. I said it's a welcome question. And it's very pertinent, especially in this time of hardship. The plan has a direct conversion of this lecture.
Sulaiman, the network is actually breaking. I couldn't get you too. Maybe you may need to come out and come in again. In the meantime, we'll take Latif or Layinka. Please log off and log on again. If you do raise up your hand again, I will take you back. Latif or Layinka, go ahead, please.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. First of all, I want to appreciate our speaker, Sheikh. May Allah SWT reward you for this submission. Actually, in my community, we have this kind of arrangement, but at the end, brothers that we have, it distrust us. I don't know how we can build trust in our community so that this help will not be discouraged by some attitude of our brothers. It's really painful when people gathered money together and so that they can finance some of us that are not rich enough in business. But at the end of the day, it is so unpalatable that they don't even return the money we gave to them, talk less of making profit from what we have gained or what they have done as a business. Please, my question is that how can we be able to train ourselves in trusting ourselves and making at least to forge ahead in our assisting people? Thank you.
You know, it's a very valid point. Even in banking, they will tell you that the first thing they look at when lending is character. Okay, if people don't have character, don't even bother lending to them. And I think what you're saying points to a big problem in the Ummah, which is the total collapse of values and character building. And again, maybe this is where communities have failed, where we have not built and instilled in the young people the virtues of honesty, the virtues of sincerity, the virtues of decency, of honor, of shame, in a properly trained environment. It would be a matter of shame for someone living in the neighborhood to take money where he knows everybody knows they've taken the money and not pay. He would probably be go and hide his face in shame or even run away from that environment. So we do have a lot to do. And I think it just makes the point that in a Muslim environment, it's not just about money. It's also about the entire value system of the Ummah. There's a whole ecosystem that we need to work on. And there are people who work on it. You've got the local imam, you've got the local, unfortunately, in many places, even the local imams are corrupt, even the alfas are corrupt. And we have it's a national problem, not just a Muslim problem. But this is where I think as a country we've lost it, and this is where the community needs to take responsibility and rise. And again, part of what you could do is work on that. How do you give them training, including training on values before you give them the money? How do you let them understand that it is in their own interest and the interest of other youth like them? Form pressure groups, okay? You get the youth together, you've got 40 of them. They understand that if some of them do not pay, they are going to make it difficult for others to get. And if there's a need, I think you can have peer pressure. This is how the microfinance institutions work. And so you've got all sorts of ideas out there from the modern financial system, from how informal how institutions have been lending informally outside the formal structures, and how they have been able to recover their funds, including, getting them to sign contracts that are legally binding so that if they deliberately refuse to pay, they can be held responsible and accountable for it, because this is a business transaction. Even in Islam, the mudaraba, the girad, the musharaka, these are business transactions. If you did that with someone who they didn't pay, you would go to the courts, and they are enforceable contracts. So these are things that we've got to all put together. So just think of yourself as a financial institution, and then operate like that.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. I will go back to the Q&A tab before going back to the audience. Let me take about three more from Q&A tab. The first question is, can you explain more on the Kapafu? You were trying to give an explanation at that time. The second question is on conventional mortgage, how do we approach it? You've answered the issue of the trust issues, which we have, but most importantly, practically, someone is asking, how do we ensure security of funds in this type of arrangement? I know you've touched on it, but somebody is still asking that particular question. That's Sulaiman Ibidunya. You can go ahead, sir.
So takaful literally means mutual support or mutual guarantee, okay? Because kafala in Islam is to support, okay, to protect. And when you have the a suffix ta, it makes it mutual, okay? So you, for example, nasr is to help, and then tanasr is to help each other, okay? Shura is to consult, tashawur is to consult each other, takafu is to help each other. So the basic idea, the basic principle of takafu, which has now become Islamic assurance, is for you to support each other. So let's say you have a group of 40, 50 people who own KK Napep in a community, and they said they're going to have a takaful arrangement. They agree, okay, look, every month each of us will come and drop a few hundred naira, a few thousand naira every month and into a fund, okay? Now, and the idea of that fund is, in the event that a disaster befalls one of us, okay, the fund will buy him a new kekinapep. So that basically is how it works. It is about protecting your wealth, okay, from factors that are beyond your control, but in a manner that is Islamically legitimate. You're not doing riba. You're not into usury. It's your money. It can be invested in legitimate business. The fund can be invested in legitimate business to grow. Okay, that is Islamically compliant, but it is to protect yourself in the event of something happening that is beyond your control, so that you do not just move from having a means of livelihood to having no means of livelihood. That is the underlying principle of takaful, and that's the underlying principle of the insurance companies that you have that are called takaful companies. So it's something that can be done on a community basis. For conventional mortgages, this is a matter that has been debated at great length by people, especially when the mortgage is taken to own a first house, where you do not have accommodation and you need a house to live in with your family, and the only way you can get that house is to pay interest. Sheikh Abdullah bin Bayya wrote a book called Sina'atul Fatwa wa Fiqhul Aqliyat, which, and in that book, one of the questions he addressed was this question of when you have to pay interest on a mortgage to own your house, and that is the only possible source of income. And his view is that, first of all, the standard view among Muslim jurists is that when a need becomes widespread, it is treated as a necessity, as darura. It is, for example, not acceptable for the Muslim Ummah to be totally excluded from economic activity because we are afraid of interest. Okay, because the damage to the community of Muslims not being in the economy is far more severe than the damage of usury. We have had cases, I remember cases in Kano many, many years ago, where people refused to borrow from banks and because they did not want to, businessmen refused to borrow from banks because they did not want to pay interest, and they considered this usury. However, you had non-Muslims who would borrow from the banks, set up factories, okay, and then our children will go and be employed in those factories, earning labor income, okay? You're being paid from the business that is based on interest anyway, and you're earning labor income rather than getting higher returns that are capital. So Bimbaya also makes a distinction between he who pays interest and he who takes interest. The interest in the initial tahrim or prohibition is from the consumption of interest. يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ لَا تَأْكُلُوا الرِّبَا أَضْعَافًا مُضَاعَفًا الَّذِينَ يَأْكُلُونَ الرِّبَا إِنَّمَا يَأْكُلُونَ فِي بُطُونِهِمْ نَارًا وَأَخْذِهِمُ الرِّبَا وَقَدْ نُهُوا عَنْهُ وَأَكْلِهِمْ أَمْوَالَ النَّاسِ بِالْبَاطِلِ. This is all referring to those who take the riba, who collect the riba, so the banks themselves. Now, giving riba was prohibited because it's a means to consuming riba. So they say taking riba was prohibited in its own self, taharim haramun li nafsihi, while giving riba was prohibited because it leads to the consumption of riba and haramun lil wasila. Now, that which is prohibited because it's a means is a lower level of prohibition than which is prohibited because in its own self. And therefore, in the case of haja, of a need, not necessity, you can pay riba. In the case of necessity, you can take riba because your necessity is darura. That's a much higher level of need. And then haja is a need. So Bimbaya actually gave this fatwa, especially to Muslims living in Europe and living in societies where the economies operate on that basis. You need to borrow, you do need a house, you need to own a house, you cannot continue living in rented accommodation if you can afford to have a roof over your head. So if you have to borrow and take a mortgage and pay interest on your house, he says that is acceptable. This is the fatwa of Sheikh Bimbaya. And it's the same fatwa that's been given by a number of scholars. Security of funds, as I said, you've got to look at character, you've got to look at a means of monitoring, because even in the traditional mudaraba and musharaka, if you feel that the person you've given the money has misused it, or if you feel that he was in a mudaraba, for example, if he's careless, then he's obliged to pay you back. If, however, he's been diligent and he's done his best, and then you lose money because you're also taking a risk. Remember, you're taking a risk, it's a business risk. If the business fails, you lose money, or you lose some of the profit, or you lose part of the money. If, however, if the business succeeds, and if he's diligent in the management of resources, you're entitled to your money and to the profit. So you've got to take every measure to monitor, you've got to set up the processes to make sure that there is control over these funds, and that you see how they apply.
Okay, sir. I will take two more from the Q&A tab before going to the audience. A quick question: can this system be used to replace Zakat? That's this system of Mudabara. Then can it be used to replace Zakat? The second question is: is it proper for a Muslim to borrow or loan money from banks with interest? You've actually answered it anyway. You've actually answered it now. But the one that is very interesting is from South Africa. How best can we overcome laziness among Muslim youths?
So the first question, absolutely not. It cannot replace Zakat. Nothing can replace Zakat. If you have wealth that has reached nisab, Zakat is among the five pillars of Islam. It's absolutely non-negotiable. Okay, so you must give Zakat out of your wealth, and you must give it to those eight categories or some of those eight categories that are listed very clearly in Surah At-Tawbah. In the masadaqatu lil fuqara'i wal masakin wal amilina alayha wal mu'allafati qulubihim وَفِرْ رِقَابِ وَالْغَارِمِينَ وَفِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ وَابْنِ السَّبِيلِ. Those eight asnaf al-thamaniya, as they are called by the fuqaha, are the eight categories or recipients of zakah. So nothing replaces zakah. You have to, zakah is what Allah has imposed upon you. Okay, everything else you do here is something you are taking upon yourself, seeking the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And you must always first of all, we comply with what Allah has imposed. Many of us make that mistake. People spend all their time going for, I know people who've gone for Umrah 20 times and they've not done Hajj. Okay? Allah will not ask you why you did not do Umrah, but He will ask you why you did not do the Hajj when you had the means to do the Hajj. Okay? You will be asked why you did not pay Zakah. Zakah is a pillar of Islam. It's an absolute, it's one of the five pillars of Islam. And in fact, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu actually waged a war against those who refused to pay zakah after the death of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He took them as having committed apostasy, okay? Because the zakah was an indication of their commitment to the religion. So this does not replace zakah. If you have wealth enough. Enough savings to pay zakah, you pay your zakah. Sadaqah does not replace zakah. Okay, mudaraba or musharaka, none of these replace zakah. Zakah is an absolute requirement and you must pay it. Borrowing from banks, I've already made the point. If an economy is such that the only way you can conduct commercial and financial transactions is to use interest, then the danger to the ummah of financial exclusion outweighs the risk of riba. Okay, so you will have to participate in that economy. However, we will have to continue doing our best to encourage the development of Islamically compliant products, okay, that reduce the amount of usury in our transactions.
The last one on our best can overcome laziness.
Laziness. This is now about again about social norms. It's about it's unfortunate, and we seem to have this problem a lot among Muslims. I don't know if we have it in other communities, but everywhere we seem to have this problem among the youth. They have this sense of entitlement. They think that the people that they're there to be liabilities on people, and it's extremely important for us to focus, like I said, on training, on giving them the Islamic values. Let them understand the meaning of self-worth, and it's all about upbringing. Unfortunately, you find that in our communities in general, we have all become nuclear families. Okay, we're not interested in our neighbor's children. We're not interested in what happens to the child next door. We all focus on our own children, and these are all unfortunately, these are all situations that we have gotten ourselves into that are not consistent with the values of the ummah. We no longer think of ourselves as a community. And I think if some of us who have gone through careers, who have gone through professions, who encourage our children to do the same, if we just took a step out and took an interest in other people's children, even if the parents do not, okay, help those understand and have a sense of purpose, I think we can contribute in our own way to that.
Thank you, sir. I will take three from audience. Dr. Falake Ofoedowo first, then Dr. Amin, and then Brother Sulaiman Abdelmajid back. Dr. Falake, please go ahead, please. You can unmute and go ahead.
Thank you very much. Assalamu alaikum, wabarakatuh. I wanted to ask, and I think you've touched on it, but just to clarify, I've seen a scheme like that in the US where people invest in like training athletes, they invest in their training and then they get them into like the professional league. It's a kind of like a company, and they now sign an agreement to take a certain percentage of their earnings. And of course, they alleviate the poverty of the family and all of that. And so can such a thing be done Islamically, is that correct? And can it be done for things like education? So for instance, you see a young chap who's, you know, good with computers or good with his hands, can make furniture, and you pay for his training school to maybe woodwork school or computer school. And the agreement is maybe for the next 5 years, you would take 30% or whatever percentage of his income. Or you could support him in building, like, okay, you do woodwork school, and then I set you up to have your own carpentry shop, and then blah blah blah. So that's my question. Thank you.
I mean, that is exactly what Mudaraba is. I mean, that it's an agreement between someone who owns capital and someone who owns the skill and expertise. So the contribution can you hear me?
Yes, you can go ahead. I've muted. Thank you. Go ahead, sir.
Okay. So the contribution of the mudarib, the person who is the agent, is his skill. He goes out. I mean, look, daraba in originally is basically to go out. Okay, to walk around. Okay, so he makes the effort. Okay, it's his effort, it's his skill that he puts in, and you provide the capital as the rabul mal, and then you have a share of the profit, and also you are entitled to the capital being returned to you. So if you invest in his education and his training, and he agrees that, and the agreement is you're going to get him into a professional job or into a business, but that over a period, first of all, you'll be sharing the profits. And then over a period, he's going to pay you back the money you've invested. That is exactly what Mudaraba is.
Okay, sir. Dr. Amin Mustafa. Dr. Amin Mustafa, you can unmute. Okay, Sulaiman. Okay. Sulaiman Abdulmajid.
Yes.
Okay, I will go back to when they're ready, they will signify. So,
Ijara.
I was actually in that we had a problem.
Within this community, engage informal. Okay, so I was saying many in these communities engage in this informal investment, and we also partake in them just to help or contribute our little, whatever we can to our communities, right? But oftentimes, these transactions are documented, but they are sort of outside the formal banking or fund management systems. The issue here, or the concern that often happen, is the inavailability, or would I say maybe unawareness, of effective recourse and dispute resolution system in these informal transactions. And even where you try to, the costs of, you know, enforcing or going through the legal hurdles sometimes outweigh the entire transaction, especially when you're looking at, you know, very small scale business setups. But you need to, there's need to, you know, to go through legal, we should to set an exam, sorry, to go through legal process. And under certain circumstances, even if it is just to set an example, you know, to correct certain perception of, you know, free lunch for everyone, right? So I really like your thought around this, Sheikhana. What do you think? How do you think we can sort of navigate this system for continuous support and not to discourage those who are, you know, supporting with the little that they can? Jazakumullah khair.
You know, I don't know what part of the north, but look, I know about Kano, okay? And in Kano, we do have a robust informal traditional system for dispute resolution, okay? The traditional structures from the emir to the district head, to the village head, and to the ward head, Mayongwa, at the level of the ward, with Mayongwa and the imam, you have a very robust system, okay, where these things are addressed, and they can go all the way, and they're not expensive. And I had many cases come to me of disputes over over financial transactions, and we had a process of where you would take them to a district head, and they would sit down and reach an agreement on how the payment is going to be made and monitor, and they report back when it's done. People actually came themselves to say they would like the Emir to intervene because they have a dispute over financial transactions. I would ask a retired cadi or someone to sit down with them and work out a solution. So if you involve these structures from the beginning, and they take responsibility, and they know, because you have a ward head, where he should be interested in seeing that the youth in his environment get access to these funds, and that they and he will see the benefit of this investment in his own community. If you involve these structures from the very beginning, you improve the chances of a resolution that does not require you going to a court of law or going through a very expensive process.
Thank you, sir. One last question before we go back to Akia and Nita. Sulaiman, are you available now?
Yes, I am. Hello?
Yes, go ahead, please.
Okay. I'd like to thank the lecturer once again. So what I was asking is that, is it possible to get the record of the lecture
Okay, you will get the recording of the lecture. Just check your chat. I'm posting the link in there. We have our next lecture too, next week, Saturday at 10 a.m. And I'll also share the link in there. We'll update that one too. That's another opportunity. Also, too, if you drop your phone number, I can add it to the group where you can see all the details of our previous lectures. And it's like a small Islamic community. Thank you, sir.
Sorry, contribution, sir. Can I go ahead?
Okay, go ahead, please.
Yes.
Yes, please. This is just my own modest contribution. I hope it will be taken just as that. Concerning the issue of trust, I think lack of trust is a deficit. Is an obvious deficit, but the availability of trust as well is not inherited by just mere chance. And if we all go by Islamic history, the situation, the process which the Arabs went through under the guidance of our holy and noble Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was a process of dawah, which addressed issues in society. Today, in our current crisis, what do we find that we've abandoned dawah? Just a few. If it's the rest of the few are fast, few are sheikhs. Whereas the rest of the male, so far, the sound process.
Thank you, Sulaiman. Unfortunately, we couldn't get it very well. The network again is still a bit fuzzy on your side, but thanks for the contribution. Did drop your phone number, we'll add it to the group so that you can actually get access to previous recording. And also too, by next week, this particular recording will have actually been ready. I will post it here too. Khalifa will continue with the question and answer tab. The next question is on riba and what's the consequence, Islamic consequence of riba and the punishment of the borrower of money in a non-interest bank, especially when he had little or no choice. I know you've had it answered this. You've actually outweighed the risk, so I think we can leave this. Next question is on surplus. What is surplus?
I would just say that riba is haram. Okay. I have not said it is legitimate. Riba is haram. It is one of the strongest harams in Islam. However, what I said is that according to the scholars, if the economy is such that it is absolutely impossible for you to conduct business or to meet your needs without partaking in riba, then you do that.
Okay, sir.
That's an essay. Okay.
The next one is, what is surplus? That's Aliafu in the Nigerian context. I will take one more before you answer that. There are business ideas which requires getting capitals from non-interest sources. Please, how do we go about it? There are business ideas which requires getting capitals from non-interest sources. Please, how do we go about it?
Well, on the last one, I mean, this is what we're talking about. We're talking about individuals who are wealthy, basically providing capital. But remember that non-interest sources does not also mean no returns, because you can Allah has made profitable transactions legitimate. وَأَحَلَّ اللَّهُ الْبَيْعَ. So if you make a profit, you share that profit. That is not interest. It is profit sharing, because the source is also sharing in the loss. The Islamic banks do that. If you go to any of the Islamic banks, you will get it. And if there are individuals who are ready to do that for you, they can. But like I said, it is a business proposition. You have a business idea. It is profitable. People invest in that idea and they expect a return. That is not the same as interest. On the question of what is the other question I missed?
Last question is that what is surplus? That's Al-Afu in the Nigerian context.
Well, I don't know about a Nigerian context. My understanding of Afu is that which you do not need, which is so when you have met your own basic needs and you're not taking from your needs, then any surplus is Afu. It is out of that surplus that you do these things. I think you're referring to the verse, yes, alunaka ma'idha yunfiqoon qulil afwa. They ask you, what do they spend? And he says, afwa, that you spend out of that which is the surplus. You can't take what you need to feed your family, for example, or to educate your children, or to pay back your debt, and then give it away. Okay. However, if you've met your own basic needs and you have a surplus, that is when you do your nafaka.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. I will continue with the tab. The question on what can established organization like IBM support emerging non-interest companies? I think that's actually been answered. So I will jump on that one. The next question on Ridwan, from Ridwan Lawal, regarding how can rich people or privileged people really identify those in need? I think we have that in there. Several Islamic organizations does that. Nasfat does that. Alaji Lawal Kankia does that. Same thing. You can actually reach out to those organizations to help you identify those in need, and they will do all the logistics and then the distribution.
The reality, my brother, is that poverty stares us in the face everywhere we go.
Yes.
Poor people are not difficult to find if you want to find them.
Okay. The next question is from Anonymous. Assalamu alaikum. I would like to ask if we're permitted to adopt the same principle of wealth circulation in our Christian dominated neighborhoods, or do we need to actively seek out Muslims to benefit from this?
You know, if you look at the basic principles of zakat, one of the eight categories is al-mu'allafati qulubuhum, those whose hearts you seek to pull. And I think if you think that by being kind to and generous and helpful to the Christians in your environment, you can attract them to Islam, or you can at least give them an impression of Islam that is different from the impression that they have, or they may have been fed, or the stereotypes that they may see, I think it should be a good thing.
The question on the trust, you've answered that. But this is a very interesting question on what's the Islamic stand on network marketing business, like many network marketing companies in Nigeria now. You know, all those network marketing that they do, network marketing that they sell their products and all those stuff. is asking what's the Islamic stand on it.
But I mean, if you talk about the network or the internet as just a means of delivering a product, these you know, Islam does not deal with means or wasila, okay? Whether you're using the internet or the TV or the radio, it deals with the end. So the general rule in Islamic jurisprudence is that it is the end that will determine the ruling on the means. So if you use any kind of tool, any kind of intermediary to get to an end, if that end is haram, then the means is haram. If the end is halal, the means is halal. If the end is wajib and you can only reach it through that that means, then the means becomes wajib. If it's makruh, then it's makruh. So it is not so much what you do, it's not so much using the internet or the network, but what transaction is at the end of it. If the transaction is legitimate, then a network is legitimate.
Yes, you've answered it. The network marketing that they're talking, like Oriflame, like Forever Living, all those companies that does network marketing, they distribute, they don't use the normal channels of distribution. They use mouth-to-mouth, word of mouth distribution channels. But you've said it also, if the transaction is legitimate, it is really, really legitimate. And it's different from illegitimate transactions. I have Rahim Ikumane on the line from the audience. Rahim, go ahead, please.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Thank you very much for the opportunity. And it is great to hear from the great Khalifa, mashallah. I just have a question. I'm Rahim Ngumane from South Africa. We are based in Pretoria. So we have built a masjid that has a community center. And in the community center, alhamdulillah, since 2019 to date, we've managed to graduate about 64,000 youth. And we've taken them through entrepreneurship training and so on and so forth. But the challenge that we have in most cases is that we have a problem with consistency. Many of our youth, they are not really that consistent. You know, we will have 10 come in. At the end of it all, you'll only find 3 will be left to graduate. So if Amir can probably maybe advise as to how best can we encourage our youth to be consistent in what they're doing, and also how best we can come up with a model that can, yes, you have touched on how we can try and make sure that they pay back the loan by tying them up on some contracts. And I would like to know, how do we encourage them to stay consistent on whatever it is that they are doing, in particular entrepreneurship? Because if you don't have consistency and discipline in entrepreneurship, really nothing works out. Shukran jazila.
Well, thank you very much. I think, first of all, it's important to encourage you to be patient and to continue. One of the rules in fiqh, qawaid al-fiqhiyya, is مَا لَا يُحْسَلُ كُلُّهُ لَا يُتْرَكُ جَمِيعُهُ. That which you cannot attain 100%, you do not allow to escape 100%. So if you cannot keep the 10 and you're keeping 3 or 4, it's better than losing all the 10. So the first thing is to encourage you to please not be discouraged by the fact that some of them do not complete. And I think it is the consistency on your part and the success stories that you're able to show that will continue to attract other people and increase the level of retention. At the end of the day, a model works if it is seen to succeed. And alhamdulillah, if Allah places barakah in this model and other young people see that those who have maintained a consistent path have succeeded, hopefully you'll get more and more people who take them as role models. So it's just about constant effort. And I know what you're talking about. This whole generation, this Generation Z, I mean, we all have them. We have them as children. We see them around. for all of us, it is very, very difficult given how we grew up, given the kind of attitudes that we had, given the kind of values that were instilled on us. We can't understand the entitlement culture that we have. And it's all over the world. It's all over the world. I don't know, is it because their life has been so easy with the telephones at their disposal, with the internet at their disposal, with the TV and with the games, that they basically have not had time? Or is it our fault? Have we spent just so much time teaching them mathematics and English and history and economics and not teaching them other things, other values? We've got to do a lot of reflection. But I find that this thing you're talking about, this attitude, it's not just in the Muslim community. The Americans are complaining, the Europeans are complaining, the Chinese are complaining about this generation. And I think it will take a lot of patience on our part and consistency to keep them on the straight and narrow.
Jazakallah khair.
Wa iyyakum. Okay, I can't hear anything.
While we're waiting for the coordinator, can we have Dr. Alimi Abdulrazak? If you can unmute yourself, sir.
Assalamu alaikum, Abdullah.
Alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Yeah, Sheikh. Thank you very much for your incisive and enlightening statement this morning. My question has to do with cryptocurrency. What are your views on this, and is it acceptable in Islam? Thank you very much.
To be honest, my understanding of crypto is very, very limited. These are things that came long after I left the central bank. I think here in Paris, a book on crypto and on artificial intelligence, trying to educate myself about it. I've seen this week in the news, one of the crypto giants just jailed for 25 years for stealing $8 billion from people. And I mean, to think that there's so much money in the currency for one young man to just steal, you know, is itself frightening. My understanding is that there's a lot of speculation in it. Islam discourages speculation. You basically, it's called garar. The risk is just too high of either making a lot of money or losing it. And I'm not sure that it is anything, it is tied to any kind of real economy transaction. And generally, Islamic jurisprudence encourages or discourages any kind of financial transaction that is not tied to the real economy, to a very clear good or service that's been financed. But I am no expert in crypto. And I have not read the fatwas on crypto. I'm sure there are fatwas on it. And I would be hesitant to give a fatwa or to give a response on something I'm not an expert in. But it's an area that I've got to study, because I keep getting these questions from people who ask me if they can do crypto. And I've never done it. I've never really paid much attention to it. But we'll see.
Professor Hamid, thank you, sir. Professor Hamid, go ahead, sir.
Thank you very much. I want to thank the Khalifa for this insightful lecture. Well, I just have 2 points. One, earlier on when I was requesting that the imams in our mosque should be the coordinators for this empowerment, and the Khalifa then said that many of the imams and clerics are corrupt. It came back to me that, again, well, do we even take care of these imams and clerics in the first instance? And if the principle that they were like, that is those who work on zakah should be taken care of, So how do we actually take care of our imams in terms of their own personal needs? And I think that's an area we need to look at. Now let us have an established system whereby the imams and clerics will be taken care of, and that they can then be, because they are close to the community, and they can then assist the people in the lower rung of the society to be empowered. That's number one. Number two, well, there has been this conflicting fatwas on payment of zakat on contributory pensions. A lot of weird and perhaps a controversial thing. So what do you think about somebody in the system contributing, having pensions, and the pensions, of course, he doesn't have access to it perhaps until he's retired. Does he or she have to pay zakat on that? Whenever it goes. And the last one is the enlightenment on the part of our Muslims, especially groups. I think we need to do more. Even the imams and Islamic groups are not very much aware about how the principle of al-darura tubihul mahdurat, that is necessity, making illegal legal in terms of interest, should be done. I think we should need to discuss along that line. Thank you very much.
Oh, thank you very much, Professor. First of all, I hope I have not given the impression that imams and alfas are corrupt. I said some of them. I think many of them are not. And yes, we should make sure that we take care of them and they meet their basic needs. This is a principle that was established, I think, from the time of Omar, radiallahu anhu, where when people take themselves out of a position of earning in order to serve the community, either as qadis or as imams, and they're not in business, because I mean most qadis are not expected to be business people. They're supposed to just keep away from the system and just apply justice. And the same thing with most of the imams. Yes, if there's we should think of how we provide for them, provide for their accommodation, provide them with the means to survive, so that they do not deviate from their own teachings and their own principles. So yes, the mosques are a very important center. I mean, the mosques unfortunately have been just turned into places where you go and pray. The mosque in Islam is the center of all activity. The Prophet, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he went to Medina, the first thing he did was to build his mosque, and he participated in building the mosque himself. And that was where prayers were held. That is where teaching was done. That was where meetings were held. That's where you had your marriage. That's where you had a war strategy. That's where you had your diplomatic missions. You remember the Christians of Najran, when they came, that was where the Prophet hosted them. They even had their Christian service in his own in the mosque. So I think reviving the mosque as the center of the activity of Muslims, economic, social, religious activities, would be a very vital part of this renaissance that we're looking for. On the zakah, on contributory pension, if you think of the contributory pension as wealth that is saved, and you want to pay zakah on it, if you think of it as just a surplus wealth that is saved, that is about, but my understanding is that most people who make contributory pensions still have other liabilities. Remember that for zakah, your wealth is measured not just in terms of what you own, but what you own net of what you owe. So I have many people have contributory pensions, but they still have loans from banks. You need to net off all of that before you calculate the nisab, and then see if that constitutes a saving that has been in place for a year before you pay zakat. This is my reading. I would recommend that we go to Yusuf al-Qardawi's Fiqh al-Zakah and see if he addressed this question, because he addressed many of the modern questions that have come up on zakat. And it's a book that's widely available. I would suggest that we go there and look at it and see what arguments he may have made. enlightenment is important. I think I've seen Nur Lemu do a lot now and focus on usul al-fiqh and qawaid. Most of us as Muslims are very familiar with fiqh and jurisprudence. Many of us do not understand and do not have much understanding of the rules of fiqh, the qawaid al-fiqhiyya. This idea of adharat to be al-madharat or al-mushaqqa, tajlibu taysir, and so on. All of these rules that we're quoting, this qawaid is an important component of fatwa. You cannot address changing situations and changing circumstances and new situations without understanding of usul and qawaid. And yes, we need to have much more enlightenment, even among traditional scholars, okay, who are good with tafsir and hadith and fiqh. Not many have a proper understanding of usul and qawaid and apply these rules. Having said that, ad-darurat, darura is a very clear term. Haja is a clear term. Tahsin is a clear term because you've got different levels. And there are times when we confuse what is really a haja with a darura, or what is a tahsin or tahsiniya or mukamila with a darura. So even understanding what darura is absolutely necessary. At what level you can begin to make it lawful.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Professor Hamidu Sani. Prof was a former VC of Convener University. Khalifa, we have lots of Q&A here, but I'm aware of 12 o'clock as a, I'm aware of the time box of 12 o'clock. So I will take two more questions on the audience before now focusing on the Q&A tab. The two people on the audience, Dynamic Portfolio, please unmute and ask, and then Siki. So both will ask their questions and then you can address them once. Dynamic Portfolio, can you unmute, please? Okay, Siki, can you unmute and ask your question, please?
Yes. Salaam alaikum, Your Eminence Khalifa, and thank you so much for such a wonderful lecture. My question is actually, which is better in the sight of Allah, subsidizing or sponsoring pilgrimage by the government and or individuals, or using that money to empower the less privileged Muslims? I read somewhere yesterday that the government bowed to pressure and is releasing 90 billion naira to sponsor pilgrims for this year's Hajj. I cannot confirm the source, but really, which is better in the sight of Allah? Salaam alaikum.
Thank you. Dynamic Portfolio, can you unmute, please? I know you've been, your hand.
Okay, can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you very well now, sir. Go ahead, sir.
Okay. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Your IS, NS, INS.
Alaikum salam.
We have, a lot of us has been approached by our Muslim Ummah for assistance one way or the other. I'm sure a lot of us has experienced this. And I was just wondering, as a way to helping and empowering our Muslim Ummah, is it a good option to set up a non-profit educational foundation focusing on our youth in the Muslim Ummah? And if you educate them, with this type of foundation, I'm hoping that they will be empowered to have a way to live a decent life. It's just a thinking, and I want your thought on that. Thank you.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. One more Khalifa before we go ahead. Sheikh Mohammed, please go ahead, sir. Sheikh Mohammed.
Salaamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum salam.
Thank you so much, Brother Khalifa, for this inspiring lecture. I'm an expert in Islamic finance and talking from Tanzania. I would like just to add about the cryptocurrency. Yeah, actually, aslu al-ashiya al-hal. The basic origin of all things is that they are permissible until there is a decree by or fatwa by the scholars that this is not permissible. So cryptocurrency, there are, as Brother Khalifa have said, maybe 98% of them are haram because they're just speculations and gharar in it. And also there is al-jahala because you are dealing with a platform using blockchain technology whereby it is P2P, means peer-to-peer transaction. You don't know the other transacting party, which falls now from the rules of fiqh in transaction because the two parties must know each other and there should be a transaction, a Sharia contract transaction known. And most of these cryptocurrencies, whether Bitcoin or whatever, they do not have a clear-cut contract of Sharia to govern them. So they fall from being halal. But they have emerged due to necessity of accessing, especially the youth accessing transaction. There are some few emerging cryptocurrencies globally, which are tied to physical assets. So they have really what is known as samania, the worthlessness of the coins, the digital coins, which are involved, and they are tied to gold. And they've got Sharia advisors, and they've got a clear-cut Sharia contract to be used. When they fulfill those conditions, they become allowable, but it's very difficult until you get experts like Brother Khalifa and others who know about the fiqh al-mu'amalat al-maliyat al-mu'asira, that is fiqh of the modern transactions. I just wanted to add on that. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. Thank you, sir. Thank you for that putting down. Sheikh will answer the previous two questions now. Dr. Jamila, you are actually on the next. Just hold on. Let Khalifa answer the questions first before coming over to you. Thank you.
Yeah, so the first question on subsidizing pilgrims. I think we should make a distinction between just subsidizing pilgrims and what has happened this year. My view is that the state is not supposed to pay for pilgrims. In fact, in Maliki law, where a Muslim is unable, a poor Muslim who has no means is unable to pay for Hajj, according to Imam Malik, it is wrong and it is not allowed for money to be taken out of the Baitul Mal, out of the treasury of the state, to finance him for Hajj. For the simple reason that Hajj is prescribed only for those who have the means. Okay, liman istata'a ilayhi sabila. So there is no basis for taking state funds to finance anybody going for Hajj if he cannot afford it, because if he cannot afford it, Hajj is not obligatory upon him in the first place. Okay, that money should be used for education, for healthcare, for security, and for whatever it is there for. Now, what happened this year is very different. What happened this year is that the government gave a price and a cost for Hajj, and people went and paid. And then because of the nature of the economic policies we ran, the foreign exchange situation, before going for Hajj, the government now comes and changes the price. Now, one way to look at it is you have a contract with the government. The government said, this is how much you pay, and you paid. And therefore, the government is obliged to take it. Another way to look at it is, look, this is a subsidy. I know because I know two people whom I've had to fund the difference for, okay, because they said they thought it was X amount, and now they've got to pay 2 million naira extra, and they're close to me, and I knew the effort they put in, so I gave them the money to pay. In fact, if I knew the government was going to pay, I wouldn't have given the money. I should have just allowed the government to pay. But honestly, I think this year is it's a matter of judgment. as to whether the government feels it has a moral responsibility, having given them a price to assist them, or whether it could also be political. It could feel that it's something that people want, and as the government, it's doing what is a popular policy. But the principle of using state funds to finance Hajj is a principle that in Maliki law is discouraged. Nobody who cannot afford Hajj is obliged to go for Hajj. This is very clear. Look, on the question of non-profit educational foundation, you know, Islam is, the religion is very, very clear on a very wide range of good things. This is why the word hasana or amal salih is used a lot in the Quran. Man ja'a bil hasanati falahu ashru amthaliha wa man ja'a bis sayyati falaysa illa mithlaha. Man sanna fil islam sunnatan hasanatan falahu ajruha wa ajru man amila biha. Every good deed, every act that falls under what is encouraged by the Quran and by the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is a sunnah hasana. So anything you do to help, whether it's education or healthcare or economic empowerment or training in religious terms, or strengthening family bonds, anything that contributes to achieving the overall objectives of the Sharia, the protection of the deen, of life, of the intellect, of nasab, progeny, and of wealth. Anything you do to protect that is part of it's one of those things that complies with the maqasid of Sharia, the ultimate objectives of Sharia. And therefore, setting up an educational foundation is something that contributes to the protection of aql, which is one of the daruriyat al-khamsa that the Sharia protects as part of maqasid, and it's something that we should encourage.
Thank you, sir. The last one we'll take from the audience because of the time constraints is from Dr. Jamila Bio Ibrahim. Dr. Jamila, please go ahead, ma'am.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Thank you very much, Your Royal Highness the Khalifa. And thank you as well to Dr. Adesola Adeduntan. My name is Jamila Bio Ibrahim. I'm privileged to serve as the Minister of Youth Development of Nigeria, and being invited to participate in this webinar has actually been very enlightening, highly insightful, considering the fact that most of the conversations have been around youth empowerment and growing concerns about access to finance for young youth-led enterprises. And of course, we understand that the reason why we're very concerned, like the Khalifa said, that most of us young people are either in the neighborhoods or are children to us all. And it goes a long way that means it's a responsibility of the Ummah, the responsibility of every single member of the Ummah to prefer strategies basically and solutions to youth empowerment. And I'm very I would like to say thank you to the Khalifa, because I've learned a lot in my participation at the webinar. I've learned a lot because considering the fact that the Ministry of Youth Development, in collaboration with other government agencies in Nigeria, is set to establish a youth development bank. And considering the fact that Nigeria is a secular state, we had a lot of concerns about how if Muslims, young Muslims, will be free to access these funds, and also remaining within the provisions of the Sharia. And thank you very much. It has actually increased the confidence and encouraged us to seek more more products, basically, to be able to design more products that would be in line with the Sharia, to ensure that everyone benefits from the solutions that this bank prefers. Thank you very much.
So Minister, as a former regulator myself, I would advise you when setting up the bank from the beginning to set it up with application for a non-interest banking window. Once it is licensed to offer non-interest banking products, you can then put in all these products as well, along with the interest-bearing ones.
Fantastic. And Your Royal Highness, it would be nice to actually sit down with you one of these days to learn more with respect to the bank.
I'm available anytime, my sister. Just reach out. I'm sure you know how to.
Yes, I do. Thank you very much, Your Royal Highness.
Thank you, Minister.
Thank you, Dr. Minister. That's the last we'll be able to take from the participants. Just quickly, sir, whatever we can actually answer that of these 167 open questions, we'll do that before 12 o'clock. I'm aware Dr. Adeduntan would like to do some sort of a closing remark, so I will give enough room for that. The first question here is about this societal ill, about betting among our youth. This betting is actually causing a lot of concerns and fueling laziness. The question is, what we want to know your opinion on betting and the ills that it's actually causing on society. That's number one. Number two, sir, hold on, sir. Let me just get two more, sir. Number two, sir, somebody is asking, if you have all these products for alleviating poverty and economic empowerment, that is it necessary for someone to implement a contract paper with the poor before disbursement? Then the last one is on, the third one is actually on, how do you manage information asymmetry and trust in Islamic financial transactions? Okay, sir, you can go ahead, sir.
Look, if betting is gambling, it is clearly haram. And I don't think it's about an opinion. It is actually the nas of the Quran, the text of the Quran. ما يريد الشيطان أن يوقع بينكم العداوة والبغضاء في الخمر والميسر ويصدكم عن ذكر الله وعن الصلاة فهل أنتم منتهون. The shaitan wants to throw enmity and hatred among you through betting and alcoholism and drinking alcohol, and to also block your path to Allah, to the remembrance of Allah, and to prayer. And then, of course, Allah says, "Wa hal antum muntahun," will you then not refrain from it? In other words, you are commanded to refrain, and it is prohibited. So it's not a matter of opinion. So long as betting is gambling, it is haram. There are, I think, instances where there has been betting, I think, on racing and on archery. I think some have said that for those two sports, because they encourage, and they're not exactly gambling, that there is some exception in those. I can't remember the details of the jurisprudence, but generally, my understanding of betting is that it is an act of gambling, and it is haram, and it's not really about an opinion. As for contract, look, again, we go back to the basics. The Quran says, "Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu idha tadayantum bidaynin ila ajalin musamman faktubuh." All you who believe, when you have a deferred obligation that is supposed to be paid at a specific time, write it down. This is an instruction. It is the longest verse in the Quran, in Baqarah. It sets out the law of contract. And the first instruction is, write it down, and let a scribe write it. Let two witnesses among your men, or one witness who is male and two witnesses who are women, sign. Okay, and he who writes should be honest in writing, and he who has the obligation should make sure that he returns that which is trust. When you add the ladhi tumina amanata, he who is entrusted with money should make sure that he fulfills that trust and does not betray that trust. And he says that is more purifying for your soul and for this. So the reality is writing a contract is at the foundation of Islamic jurisprudence. Now, where you do not find a scribe, and that's what the law says, where you do not find a scribe, where you do not write it and you do it verbally, you are still obliged to meet the trust and to return it. But in these times when it is so easy to write a contract, why is it so difficult to get somebody to sign that I have taken this money, I'm going to pay back at this time, and have witnesses who are reliable to sign it, and that contract is binding? So this is, I think, very clear. Information asymmetry, financial institutions, it's not just some financial institutions. I think the whole question of information asymmetry is there for every financial institution. What you do not know about your customer is far, far more than what you know. And I think what we need to do is make sure that we try to know as much as possible. But yes, there is information asymmetry. There are opportunities sometimes to take advantage of information asymmetry to exploit. That is where we must remember that there is somebody who has all the information, and that is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and to whom we are accountable on the day of judgment. I think one of the greatest things about Islam is at the end of the day, even when somebody is, when nobody is seeing you, even when nobody is watching you, you know that Allah is watching. This is one of the legacies of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This is one of the great things he left for us as Muslims. The knowledge that there is an omniscient being that is watching us, and we are accountable to that being. That is the most important check on our behavior. We know that he knows everything. Wallahu bi kulli shay'in alim. And we also know that whatever we say and whatever we do, everything we do is written down by the angels that are covering us. These are all matters of faith. Those who are not Muslims or those who do not believe in God or those who do not believe in angels do not believe it. But this is what our religion tells us. And that is the greatest check on us and on our lives.
Thank you, Sir Khalifa. I want to take three more questions before we round it up. They are quite related, and I know you must have touched some of them before. The next question is on Ijara, where a loan is given to a third party for capital acquisition like buying vehicles or equipment, but comes with a repayment that are in multiples of the original capital. The person is asking, isn't this form of a riba? Because the repayment is actually in multiples of the original capital. Second one is on the zakat. The 2.5% provision of zakat. The person is asking, do Supreme Council of Islamic Affairs has units addressing this on national scale? I mean, what minimum do you have for you to be able to pay that 2.5% zakat? The last one is, the next one before you do answer is on how can the Ummah benefit from the pool of funds lying idle with PENCOM, since a sizable number of us are also contributors to that fund? So those are the three, sir. If we can take that three, then we can hand over to Dr. Adeduntan for the closing remark.
Okay, I think, on the question on Ijara, and it doesn't matter whether it's Ijara or Murabaha or Qud al-Musawama, at the end of the day, I think the general position of scholars is that excess profit is riba. Profit should be reasonable, and certainly in a transaction of ijara, there should be a return. But when people begin to get multiples and multiples of their capital, it becomes exploitative, and because of the exploitation, it falls into the category of riba. I think this was ruled, I believe it was by Omar bin Khattab, but excess profit beyond the reasonable, beyond normal profit is something that falls into the category of riba because of the exploitation and the injustice in it. It is unjust. And once you begin to have injustice, then you fall into akhl amwal and nasib al batil, consuming the wealth of people through unfair means. On the question of zakat, I'm sure you know 2.5% is just on financial wealth. You've got different percentages for agricultural products. You've got and so on. And you know, in most of the states and most of the communities, there are zakat funds. I'm sure the Lagos Muslim Community may have one. I don't know whether it's something that should be done at the national level. I know in Kano there is a zakat commission in many states in the north, and I do not know if there's one in Lagos, but there's none in Lagos. There could be by the Muslim community. I'm sure there are provisions, because I've received calls from people who say, if you're paying zakat, please we distribute zakat. And so what is important is to find out. Actually, the state should be responsible for it. The government should, because the Prophet, the Quran says, "Khudh min amwalihim sadaqatan tutahhiruhum biha." Take from their wealth the zakat. So it was an instruction to the Prophet as a political leader to take the zakat and to distribute it. If the government does not have a structure for it, I'm sure the community where you are has a structure. So just try and find out where that structure is. Do your calculation and give it to them, or have somebody who can help you do the calculation based on your balance sheet, and then work it out. But then, depending on the range and the categories of assets that you have, that is extremely important, and your liabilities. Honestly, on PENCOM, I don't know how to answer that question. PENCOM does have its regulations. I don't know how you can access those funds. My view is that if there is access at all to those funds, then we should also try to have access to them. We should not allow ourselves to be excluded. My argument is always that Muslims must get themselves involved in every aspect of the economy. The Prophet said, "Kad al-faqru an yakuna kufran." Poverty is something that can lead to, or that could become disbelief. And you know, we're seeing it today. You are seeing poor people, children from poor families, converting to other religions because they've been given money. They're giving them education, they're giving them healthcare. So the economic power, financial power, is being used to take people out of Islam into disbelief. And therefore, it is a very, very big risk for Muslims to be the center of poverty, for our children to be targets, to be poached very easily. And these conversations are very important. We have some of the richest Nigerians today are Muslim, and yet the poorest are also Muslim. In Northern Nigeria, you've got poverty rates, people living below the poverty line of about 80% in many states of the North. Now, those are easy targets for people, for missionaries. You know, give them education, give them healthcare, give them some money. And the next thing you know is they say they have found a new religion. Okay, they are now born again. And they turn and they become the worst enemies of your faith. So we need to think beyond about us as individuals. We need to think as a community, as a group. We must be part of this economy. We must be part of the government. We must be part of everything. If you exclude yourself for any reason, any rule that you have in Islam that is tied to targeted at an individual, if when applied across the board, leads to the exclusion of the ummah from an important part, that rule is dropped. This is the, again, Qawaid al-Fiqhiyya. Izzuddin ibn Abd al-Salam said that when you have a haja and becomes widespread, it becomes darura. The participation, as an individual, you are not obliged to be in business. It's not an obligation. But if everybody went out of business, the community suffers. Therefore, it becomes a darura. So when you have the opportunity, you must do it. And so all of us who have the opportunity to be there should be there, because you block, you protect the Ummah in your own way and in your own position. And it's only in that process that we can provide a defense for the faith. There is no point if we cannot. The first darura is the deen, the religion, in Maqasid al-Sharia. It is the first. And these other things can lead to losing the deen. If because of poverty, people are leaving religion, then fighting poverty becomes an absolute necessity. It's not just mal, which is number five. Okay, number five becomes number one because it becomes a necessary part of protecting number one. So these are the general thoughts I have, not just on PENCOM, on everything. I do hope we will try to take them on board.
Thank you very much, sir. We unfortunately won't be able to take more on this with Bastard at one. But Khalifa, last one, for self-employed professional, when is the payment of a zakat due? Should they be counting every 12 months or should they just be targeting Ramadan or when exactly? I mean, especially for those self-employed, and you know, they don't have regular cash flow. Their cash flow may be at high at some point in time. It may be at some low at some point in time. What's your viewpoint on that, sir?
So I think in general, zakat is paid over surplus wealth that has had the haul, okay, a year. So if you have had surplus income over and above your needs, when you've netted out all liabilities, okay, saved for 12 months, then at the end of 12 months, you're supposed to pay 2.5% of that as zakat. I think Yusuf al-Qardawi covered this issue of one-off incomes, okay? And not just self-employed. If you're working in a bank, there are times when you get a fat bonus, okay? And it just hits your account, okay? One day, it's a lot of money, more than your basic needs. And he says when you get that kind of money, you just pay the zakat at that point in time. You could be a landlord and you get rental income, and that rental income may be much more than your basic needs. Again, you take what is surplus and then you pay at the point you take the rent. Or you could have an investment and you could have invested in an asset and then you sell the asset, and on selling the asset you make income. So I think Fiqh al-Zakah, that book by Yusuf al-Qardawi, is extremely important. It's a very good resource book that answers these questions. I think we should look at it. But I think I remember having read there that for these kinds of questions, when you have an irregular supply, irregular income, but that could come in a large amount, you just pay the zakat as soon as the income comes.
Okay, sir. Thank you very much, sir. We're very grateful. Dr. Adeduntan, over to you, sir.
Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen. It's been 2 hours of having the opportunity to listen to one of our leaders, one of the leading lights of Islam, like I said, not just on the continent, but globally. And I believe it's been 2 hours that's been very well spent. We've moved over and above the topic that was chosen. We've had the opportunity of asking questions across a range of issues affecting our lives as Muslims and Islam. Let me also use the platform to acknowledge the presence in our midst of a number of very senior Muslims, our leaders in our midst. We have Baba Olamide in the house. Obviously, Honorable Minister, you are recognized. Dr. Alimi Abdulrazak, Alhaji Latif Bakari, Mr. Tunde Dabiri, Mr. Remila Saki, Professor Amidu, Adam Ru, Professor Afis Oladoshu, Isaac Abiola Oladoshu, Senior Advocate of Nigeria, Mutagbi Uju, senior advocate of Nigeria, and a host of others that are too numerous to mention. I believe the importance of today's lecture is, and I'm just trying to paraphrase this, or summarize what we've learned, that there are several ways we as Muslims can intervene to provide financial assistance, support in various forms to needy Muslims and empower them. There's a popular saying in this part of the world, there is not just enough to give people fish. You must teach people how to fish. So that way they are self-sustaining and the model you put in place then becomes sustainable. Whether it's through zakat, sadakat, and the various form of loans that His Highness has highlighted. I believe also we've used the opportunity to also speak to how we can assist with education. Education actually lies at the heart of empowerment, whether you're speaking to full Western education or even vocational studies. And I believe there's a model around whether you're adopting a child or you're adopting a group of children, whether you're providing full or focused scholarship. Full scholarship means you take responsibility for everything. Focused scholarship means you are providing scholarship for specific assignment. In all this, I think the whole concept is how do we assist the Ummah to address extreme poverty? His Highness mentioned the fact that in some Muslim majority states in the country, we do have poverty rate as high as 80%, the number of people living way below the poverty line. But here we also do have a sizable number of Muslims who are able to step in and support. A classical example of how we, in a different capacity, can step in to help is what Alhaji Ibrahim Kankia, Wazir Kankia mentioned. How he has spent his own resources, and I'm privy to this, over the last 10 years, sponsoring what he called Soccer for the Alemajis, where he's been focused, pulling resources together to make impact in that area. So if all of us collectively today make up our mind whether to adopt a child or children, or even to send people on vocational studies and assist them, either by way of grant or by way of loan, to procure the necessary equipment, I believe that would be a good starting point to addressing this issue of extreme poverty and deprivation within the Ummah. His Highness actually mentioned something towards the end in responding to a question, that addressing poverty, and this is me using the term very loosely, is almost like a pillar of our religion. Because when it gets to the point where, because of poverty, people can easily be priced away by what I call peanuts. So that speaks volumes. So food for thought for all of us, Muslims, on how we can do, what we can do, and what we should be doing. I'll be remiss in my responsibility if I don't once again go back to His Highness, Khalifa Sanusi Lamido Sanusi, one of my very, very illustrious predecessors, whose shoes are very big for people like us to fill. Please, we're very appreciative of creating time today out of your very busy schedule. We continue to encourage you for the advocacy, especially as it relates to education, health, which are things that are very, very, very important for us to address this issue of extreme poverty among the Ummah, but even at the country at large and across the continent. Thank you for your time, and Ramadan Mubarak, sir.
Thank you, Ramadan Mubarak. Thank you, Shola.
Thank you, Sir Khalifa. Ramadan Mubarak to all. Thank you. I've dropped some messages on the chat box. If you really want to be added to the WhatsApp group, you can just indicate with your phone number and we will have it there. By next week Saturday, which is actually going to be the next lecture at 10 a.m., I will post the recording of this lecture online. Thank you. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.